Good evening, everybody. Hello. Good evening. Welcome to another edition of our speaker series called My Life As, sponsored by the Journalism School. How many of you were here 2 weeks ago when we had Dean Baquet from the New York Times? Very interesting that the next day, the New York Times was barred. And I wrote to him saying, wow, if you only had waited one more day, it would have been fun. But welcome back, and thank you for your patience if you've got here early and you waited for us. Tonight we have someone who has been for the past 30 years an incredibly accomplished reporter. He is one of the most persistent, careful, thoughtful, dogged, almost obsessive reporters that I have run across. Very careful and precise. He was, for 9 years, the diplomatic correspondent of the Washington Post. He traveled with three secretaries of state, Colin Powell, Condoleezza Rice, and Hillary Clinton. He wrote a book about Condoleezza Rice. He was a White House correspondent, a national correspondent, an economic correspondent. He was an award-winning correspondent and reporter about aviation safety, and he covered Wall Street for many years. He shared in two Pulitzer Prizes. But all of that did not get him on The Daily Show with Trevor Noah. None of that got him on CBS News or got him or his work to be referenced in Doonesbury cartoon last year, right? That required something else. And that required the job that he's been in for the past 6 years, where he is the fact checker for the Washington Post. His job is to sift through all of these statements that politicians and public officials make every day and adjudicate what claims are really based in fact and what claims are not based in fact. In response, he awards Pinocchios, beginning with one Pinocchio up to four Pinocchios, and he will explain how he does this. You know, I have to tell you, it's a little strange for me as the Dean of the School of Journalism. I was talking to Glenn before. The notion that we need a separate category of journalists called fact checkers is a little strange, right? Because you would think that all reporters are fact checkers, and they should be, but this is the kind of world we're living in, the ability to respond very, very quickly. And it's also a little strange to me that now the fact checkers, and this has become a movement, there are now dozens and dozens of news organizations everywhere you look who are fact checking, right? Even in real time. The fact checkers are being attacked for not being truthful. So there's a little irony in that, and I hope that Glenn will talk about that as well. Since we're at a university, I will give you a little bit of his academic background. He got his undergraduate degree at Brown. He got his graduate degree in international affairs at Columbia. In one of his interviews, he said he decided to be a reporter when he was 5 years old, and he put out a neighborhood newspaper in Cincinnati that just covered a couple of blocks. But guess what he called it? Anybody want to guess? The Cincinnati Fact. So he knew even then where his destiny was and what he was about to do. So Glenn's going to come up. He's going to talk to you. He's going to explain how he does what he does. Then we're going to ask one of our professors in the School of Journalism, John Friedman, to come up and to talk briefly with Glenn. John is a person who has covered media and business for 4 decades. He still writes a lot for TimeInc.com and Esquire.com. He worked for Bloomberg News and many other news outlets. And 30 years ago, he competed with Glenn Kessler in their first job. So I thought it would be nice to bring the two of them back together for the first time. So ladies and gentlemen, please join with me. Don't join with me yet. I have one more thing. There's been some issues in the past about sound, people not hearing well. I want you to raise your hand if for any reason you can't hear the speakers, or when they come to the chairs and they turn, sometimes you can't hear them. Raise your hand, and that will be a signal for John and Glenn to make sure that they're talking to everybody and loud enough. So don't be shy. Okay, now please join with me in welcoming Glenn Kessler.
It's nice to be back on Long Island. I was a reporter for 11 years at Newsday, And I know how important the newspaper is to the people who live and work in Nassau and Suffolk counties. For the past 6 years, as Howie said, I've been writing the Fact Checker column at the Washington Post. But Newsday actually played an important early role in the rise of political fact-checking. 20 years ago, during the 1996 presidential campaign, I was Newsday's chief political correspondent. I traveled around the country reporting on the latest charges and countercharges of Bill Clinton and his President Bill Clinton and his challenger, Senator Bob Dole of Kansas. But I was often frustrated. There was very little space available in my stories to explain that Clinton and Dole often were stretching the truth and making false claims. Now, you have to remember, this was before the days of the web, where news organizations have unlimited space. My articles had to fit in a defined space in the newspaper, and often the first thing that was trimmed by the editors was an explanatory paragraph that one candidate or the other was not really telling the truth. So on the eve of the first presidential debate, in 1996, I convinced the editors to allow me to write a long article that explained what the candidates had been claiming and how they had been often wrong. My theory was that the campaign speeches had been the equivalent of an off-Broadway tryout, and that during the debates, the candidates would rely on the same false talking points that had succeeded with audiences on the road. So this was one of the first, if not the first, campaign fact-checking article that appeared in the newspaper. Readers loved it. It turned out there was a real interest in finding out whether or not politicians were telling the truth. Now, when I moved to the Washington Post almost 20 years ago, I did the same sort of fact-checking before and after the debates in the 2000 and 2004 elections. Finally, for the 2008 campaign, we created the fact-checker column. It is now considered one of the big three of political fact-checking organizations, along with PolitiFact and FactCheck.org. Political fact-checking is increasingly part of the daily coverage of news. In politics, you only succeed if you win. After more than 30 years of covering government, politics, and diplomacy, I have found there is little difference between the two main parties on one key issue. They will both stretch the truth if they believe it will give them a political advantage. Politicians and interest groups use facts and figures to buttress the arguments for whatever policy they're advocating. Essentially, you have to look at politicians as salesmen. And just like you would not buy a used car without checking under the hood, neither should you accept what a politician says to advance his or her policy preferences without checking out the facts. Now, that is the rationale behind the Fact Checker, which I write with a colleague. At least 5 days a week, we take a detailed look at a politician's statement and examine the facts behind that claim. And then we make a ruling, ranging from one to four Pinocchios, on how truthful the statement is. It's kind of like a reverse restaurant review. So one Pinocchio is selective telling of the truth. Some omissions and exaggerations, but no outright falsehoods. For instance, Democrats often assert that women earn 79% as much as men. Now, that's a statistic from the Census Department, so that's a legitimate source. But it's just one of many ways to measure this problem, and it happens to be the worst. Differences in the life choices of men and women, such as women tending to leave the workforce when they have children, make it difficult to make simple comparisons. If you adjust for various factors, the gap is not 21 cents, but could be as little as 5 cents. Now, two Pinocchios means significant omissions or exaggeration. Some factual error may be involved, but not necessarily. A politician can create a false, misleading impression by playing with words and using legalistic language that means little to ordinary people. As an example, Senate Democrats have claimed in recent weeks that Supreme Court nominee Neil Gorsuch should meet a standard, so-called, of 60 votes for confirmation. Now, it only takes a simple majority, 51 votes to be confirmed for a position on the Supreme Court, so what are they talking about? 60 votes is a reference to the number of votes needed to end debate on a nomination if one side chooses to launch a filibuster. But filibustering a Supreme Court nominee is such a rare event that it's only happened 4 times in the history of the United States. In fact, 2 of the current Supreme Court justices, Samuel Alito and Clarence Thomas, were confirmed with fewer than 60 votes, 58 for Alito, 52 for Thomas. So Democrats are being rather slippery with their language. 60 votes is not a standard, quote unquote, for Supreme Court nominations, but Gorsuch would need 60 votes to proceed to a confirmation vote if Democrats decided to engage in a rarely used parliamentary tactic. Now, three Pinocchios is a significant factual error and obvious contradictions. This is when things get increasingly untethered from reality. For example, during the primary debates in 2016, Texas Senator Ted Cruz said that studies by the Marines found that putting women, quote, putting women in combat ended up increasing casualties both among women and men, and that it decreases military effectiveness. But when we looked into it, it turned out there was only one study had been done by the Marines, not a bunch of studies, and it actually said nothing about the presence of women in units or the impact of casualties within a unit. It turns out the relation to combat effectiveness is more nuanced. Women were prone to more injuries on the job, which reduced their combat readiness, ultimately effectiveness, but the type of task the unit was responsible for also led to more injuries among the Marines. Moreover, this argument overlooked other findings in the report, such as the fact that women have an ability to overcome their reduced height and weight by using creative problem solving. So Cruz completely twisted the results of the study for political purposes. Four Pinocchios is for whoppers. Now, frankly, that's just about everything Donald Trump says these days. I have never encountered a politician so cavalier about the facts than Donald Trump. Now, just about every politician earns a four Pinocchio ruling at some point, but it's maybe one or two times out of every 10 rulings. Hillary Clinton, for instance, earned four Pinocchios 15% of the time. Donald Trump, by contrast, earned four Pinocchio ratings 65% of the time during the presidential campaign. And now that he has become president, unfortunately, his record is no better. The list of misstatements is endless. He says the unemployment rate is 42% when it's actually under 5%. He says he watched thousands of Muslims in New Jersey cheer to fall the World Trade Center. There is no TV footage, no newspaper coverage, just scattered unconfirmed reports of five or six people celebrating, and they were not necessarily Muslim, and they were probably teenagers. He says the wives of the 9/11 attackers were sent home from the United States just before the attacks. All but one of the attackers was unmarried, and she never visited, and the wife of the married terrorist never visited the United States. Trump even says he'll save $300 billion a year in Medicare by negotiating for prescription drug prices. That sounds great, but it turns out Medicare only spends $78 billion a year on prescription drugs. That's more than fuzzy math, that's fantastic math. Now, Donald Trump says he received just a $1 million loan from his father and turned it into a $10 billion empire. Now, first of all, most experts have looked at his numbers, say he's not worth $10 billion. Maybe at best it's $3 billion. Frankly, probably it's much less than that. But more to the point, his father gave him more than a single $1 million loan. Trump inherited tens of millions of dollars. I estimate between $30 to $40 million. His father guaranteed a $70 million loan on Trump's first big project, the Grand Hyatt Hotel in Manhattan. Digging through the records, I found many other loans as well, including borrowing $9 million from his father's estate. Most famously, when one of Trump's casinos was teetering on the edge, unable to make a mortgage payment, his father bought $3.5 million in gambling chips and did not use them. Then the hotel used the cash to make a mortgage payment. Gambling regulators later said there was an illegal loan. Okay, so now that he's president, Trump's proclivity for making false claims continues unabated. He falsely says that millions of undocumented immigrants voted in the election, just enough to give him the edge in the popular vote, but there's no evidence to back up the claim. He routinely takes credit for budget savings, such as saying he saved $600 million on a Lockheed jet fighter that he had nothing to do with. At the Washington Post, we've been keeping careful track of his statements. Tomorrow, he will have been president for 50 days, and we have counted more than 220 false or misleading statements in that time. Even more astonishing, even after Trump has been proven wrong, he goes out and repeatedly makes the same false claims over and over again. You know, most politicians will quietly drop a false talking point. Mitt Romney, for instance, in 2012, used to say that the United States was the only country in the world in which people put their hands on their hearts during the singing of the national anthem. After I gave him four Pinocchios for that, in a column that included YouTube clips of people around the world singing in their anthems with their hearts in their hands, he never said it again. Now, on rare occasions, we give a Geppetto checkmark for a completely truthful statement. It does not happen often, but hope springs eternal. Now, I will readily admit that the Pinocchios are a bit of a marketing gimmick. I mean, we have to sell newspapers, after all. It is not especially scientific, and it's open to subjective analysis. The line between two and three Pinocchios is sometimes fuzzy. But I do find it a useful tool for maintaining consistency over the months and weeks of writing columns. One key goal for my column is to help consumers of news become better judges of fact-based statements. I want to help readers become more discerning about hearing the weasel words and caveats that politicians routinely insert in their statements in order to present a more rosy or dire picture than the facts would suggest. One of my favorite examples is when President Obama declared, and I quote, "Chrysler has repaid every dime and more of what it owes American taxpayers for their support during my presidency." Now, before I started writing the Fact Checker, as Howie noted, I'd spent nearly a decade as the chief diplomatic correspondent of the Post. So here's an example of how my years of listening to diplomatic code words was especially useful. Every dime and more, it sounds like such a bargain. It makes the president sound like a used car salesman. So not only did Chrysler pay back the loan with interest, but the company paid back even more than they owed. But then you see the president snuck in the weasel words, quote, "during my presidency" in a statement. What does that mean? It turned out that Obama was only counting the $8.5 billion loan that he made to Chrysler, not the $4 billion loan that George W. Bush extended in his last month in office. So in reality, American taxpayers did not recoup about $1.3 billion of the entire $12.5 billion loan. Under the president's math, Chrysler paid back 100% of Obama's loan and less than 70% of Bush's loan. A more honest presentation would have combined the two figures to say U.S. taxpayers got back 90% of what they invested. Obama thought he got away with this by inserting the words "in my presidency" in this sentence, but I gave him three Pinocchios. Now, many of the worst claims are in television advertisements. I'm now going to show two ads from 2012 and comment briefly on some of the misrepresented facts. The ads are about Mitt Romney's record in Massachusetts, one from the Obama campaign and one from the Romney campaign. I secretly wish the ads ran one after the other since they literally cancel each other out. So we could show those ads. We'll see them one after the other.
Mitt Romney on day one. The difference is strong leadership. As governor of Massachusetts, Mitt Romney had the best jobs record in a decade. Romney reduced unemployment to just 4.7%. He balanced every budget without raising taxes. He did it by bringing parties together to cut through gridlock. From day one as president, Mitt Romney's strong leadership will make all the difference on jobs.
I'm Mitt Romney, and I approve this message.
I'm Barack Obama, and I approve this message.
It started like this.
I speak the language of business. I know how jobs are created.
But it ended like this. One of the worst economic records in the country. When Mitt Romney was governor, Massachusetts lost 40,000 manufacturing jobs, a rate twice the national average, and fell to 47th in job creation, fourth from the bottom. Instead of hiring workers from his own state, Romney outsourced call center jobs to India. He cut taxes for millionaires like himself while raising them on the middle class and left the state $2.6 billion deeper in debt. So now, when Mitt Romney talks about what he'd do as president,
"I know what it takes to create jobs."
Remember, we've heard it all before.
"I know how jobs are created."
Romney economics. It didn't work then, and it won't work now.
Amazingly, Both of these ads rely on the same data to make their claims. It just depends how you manipulate the statistics at the Bureau of Labor Statistics. The Obama ad said that Massachusetts fell to 47th in the nation. That's a blended rating over 4 years, and like Obama in 2009, Romney started his governorship in tough economic times. So a blended figure brings down his overall record. The Romney ad, which says he has the best record in a decade, is not comparing him to other states, but to previous Massachusetts governors. That's a pretty low bar. The Obama ad said that Romney raised taxes and fees. Romney says he raised no taxes. The key word there is fees. He didn't raise taxes, but he did boost fees dramatically, which some would call a stealth tax increase. The Romney ad says he balanced four budgets. The Obama ad says he increased the debt by $2.6 billion. Massachusetts, like almost every state, requires a balanced budget. The governor has no choice. And state debt is very different from national debt. This is mostly for capital investments, though Romney did continue a trend of paying for some operating expenses out of debt. But as I said, you would be very confused as a viewer if you saw those one after the other. But they all use statistics from the Labor Department. In recent years, interest in political fact-checking has exploded around the globe. In 2010, there were just four fact-checking organizations in the world, three of which were in the United States. Now there are nearly 120 fact-checking organizations in just about every country in Europe and Latin America, and it's spreading across Africa and Asia as well. 11 countries have more than one fact-checking organization. It turns out that voters in many nations want to hold politicians accountable for their statements and their promises. The internet has empowered non-governmental groups and journalistic organizations to challenge politicians and even help bring accountability and journalistic rigor to countries without much of a tradition of press freedom. These groups are able to spread their reports through social media at a fraction of the cost of traditional newsprint-based media. I recently helped craft an international set of principles to guide this movement going forward, which included committing to fact-check all political parties fairly and without favor. Now, one question I frequently get from non-journalists is, how do I prevent my own personal political beliefs from swaying the rulings that I make on statements by politicians? I actually think it's a funny question, because as a journalist, I am trained to let the facts lead the way, rather than any personal beliefs I might have. I understand how in this highly partisan age, people can be surprised that personal beliefs do not play a role in reporting. But that's how the way it works in journalism. The facts matter, not the politics. In fact, I challenge anyone to read The Fact Checker for a month, and I guarantee you, you will not be able to figure out my personal political beliefs. I'm tough on everyone, and have managed to annoy just about every interest group in Washington. During the campaign, anti-gun groups became riled because after Clinton said in a debate that 33,000 Americans die from guns every year, I noted in a fact check that 60% of gun deaths in the United States stem from suicide. Anti-gun groups thought this fact was irrelevant. But there is actually no documented link between suicide and access to guns, according to an extensive study by the National Academy of Sciences. In fact, Japan has the toughest gun laws in the world and the highest suicide rate. Expanded access to information for both readers and reporters has many advantages. But the technological changes have also come at a cost. Newspapers and the evening news shows used to provide Americans with a common point of reference. Now Americans are increasingly sorted into ideological cul-de-sacs, able to decide if they want their news slanted right or left. The internet, in many ways, has helped open a world of information and facts for Americans. But that freedom is wasted if Americans are content to only absorb facts and political analyses that match their blue or red political inclinations. We seem to have gotten richer with information, but poorer in knowledge and understanding. You have to be willing to look beyond the conventional wisdom. One thing everyone should do is diversify your social media feeds. If you're a liberal, follow some conservatives. If you're a conservative, follow some liberals. Read the people who will challenge your point of view. Neither side has a monopoly on the truth, and the other side of the debate isn't evil either. If you only read people you agree with, you become intellectually lazy. I find I often learn more from people I disagree with because it forces me to challenge my own assumptions. And you're never too young or too old to learn something new. Thank you very much.
Hello, thanks for coming. Now let's get serious now. What's the most egregious Pinocchio you've assigned so far?
Well, this is like choosing among my children. I've done probably 1,200, 1,300 fact checks now. In the recent campaign, the figure that I mentioned, where Donald Trump said he would save $300 billion in Medicare when there's only $78 billion spent on prescription drugs, that was pretty egregious. And in fact, in one of the debates, Chris Wallace actually took my statistics and put them on a card and said, "Mr. Trump, this doesn't add up." And Trump said, "Yeah," basically said, "Yeah, it does." So, in the past year, that sticks out at me.
Would you say you have an impact on the politicians at all in your work? I know the Pinocchios are very important to you and very serious, but they seem to mislead or exaggerate or even lie all the time anyway.
My job is not to change the behavior of politicians. Politicians are going to do what they're going to do. My job is to inform voters. Better informed voters might make more informed choices. One of the major goals I have is if you read the fact checker on a regular basis, you should get a better understanding of the complexity of policymaking in Washington. Many issues are very difficult and complex. There's not a lot of space in the newspaper to go through those particular issues. So you can learn about healthcare policy or budget policy by reading the fact checker. So it's the politicians, they're always going to be misleading people. But if you're informed, you don't have to pay attention to them.
President Trump, as we all know by now, can be very vindictive toward the media. He's not a big fan of a lot of our work. Have you heard from President Trump at all or his people so far?
I've not heard personally from him. I did when I wrote about his claim that thousands of Muslims were protesting after 9/11, I said the thing was so egregious he should apologize. He then tweeted he was owed an apology. So I don't know if that was a response to me. His staff is not necessarily the most responsive to fact-check inquiries. They've gotten a little better now that they're in the White House. During the campaign, it was very difficult to get any answers from them. Which was in contrast to, for instance, the staffs of Jeb Bush or Hillary Clinton, both of whom were kind of wonky politicians and surrounded themselves with wonky staffers who were quite willing to engage in lengthy debates about the sources of their information. But the Trump people in general didn't show much interest in necessarily clearing things up.
We'll accept the answer. It's a good factual answer, I suppose. We'll accept that. I suppose your life was really complicated and very busy on debate night in the last year or so, whether Republicans, Democrats, or both. What was it like for you and your colleagues to be doing this job and in such pressure?
Actually, debate night is one of the easiest nights for me.
I stand corrected.
The reason is, since we are fact-checking day in and day out, there's virtually nothing they're going to say on the stage that we haven't already fact-checked. And like I said, and that was when I did the Newsday article, they road test these things on the campaign trail, and then they rely on their old talking points when they're in a debate situation. So what we found was, we literally had summaries, quick little summaries of every fact we thought they were going to say. They'd say it, and we'd say, okay, put that up. There we go. Boom, boom. So we had to laugh. These other news organizations would say, "Oh, we have 10 or 12 of our best reporters trying to," and they were like scrambling around trying to figure out the facts, but we had already fact-checked it.
One of the great debates these days in the media is, should we call President Trump a liar? That's been debated pretty heatedly, and the New York Times has come out and said pretty clearly he has not offered facts to support his conclusions, and they have called him basically that word. And the Washington Post has not so far, to my knowledge.
Right, and we won't.
Why not?
The editors decided that the word lie, first of all, it shuts down debate. And also with the word lie, you have to get in a person's head and understand, are they purposely doing this or do they happen to believe it and they're just misinformed? I've always used a Pinocchio scale. I have never used the word lie. You can kind of get where I'm coming from when I give someone four Pinocchios. But and I think in the case of Donald Trump, a lot of times I believe really believes what he's saying, even when, and he doesn't, a lot of times, people only accept things that confirm their already preconceived notions. So even when he's confronted with contrary evidence, he kind of dismisses it and passes on. So in his mind, do we know he's sitting there saying, I'm going to lie about this? Or is he saying, I'm going to lie and say Obama tapped my phones? Or is he thinking, I'm convinced Obama tapped my phones, I must be right. And in his mind, it's not a lie. So how can we use that label?
When you heard those terms, fake news, alternate reality, whatever. So how did you feel as a fact checker and a journalist about these new vocabulary words or lexicon?
Yeah, I think fake news is kind of an overused, dumb term. There's been fake news around ever since man started to speak. It's nothing new. So it's one of these strange catchphrases. I'm not a big fan of the term.
Okay. How about if Hillary Clinton had won the election? What would life have been like now if President Clinton was in office?
Well, that's an interesting question. As I mentioned, I find actually fact-checking Donald Trump to be a bit boring. There's a lot of work because he's constantly making...
Is it boring?
Boring, yes.
It surprises us.
No, it's because it's too easy. You can sometimes fact check something within minutes, right? I mean, like the Medicare thing that I mentioned. A really good fact check is one that requires me to do a lot of investigation, a lot of digging, to understand exactly how the politician manipulated the words or the statistics to come up with their factor. I mean, the ads I was showing, those assertions were all based on real information and real data. So it was quite interesting to see the little tricks they played to manipulate the data in exactly the right way they wanted to make that presentation. So fact-checking Obama or fact-checking Clinton, it was like playing chess against someone. They were very, they were misleading, but they were very skillful in the way they did it. Whereas Trump, it is what it is.
You definitely enjoy your job. We can tell you have a real passion for this kind of work. What's the most fun part of your job?
It's the eureka moment when you figure out exactly how they were trying to scam people. And then you can slap four Pinocchios down and say...
What's the hardest part of your job, by contrast?
The hardest part is keeping up with things. We look for things that are noteworthy, that allow us to explore difficult issues. We look for things that are in the news. We want to have a varied diet. We can't write about healthcare 5 days in a row. And actually, the hardest thing for me right now is... the fact that Washington is essentially a one-party government. I write about things that are important, and people that have power, and what's important are people that are in power. The people that are in power right now are the Republicans. They control the House, they control the Senate, they control the White House. But as I said, it doesn't mean I want to, lay off Democrats. They say misleading things as well, but there's... about 50% of our fact checks are suggestions from readers who are asking questions about what they hear in the news. They're not hearing much about Democrats, and all they're hearing about is what Donald Trump has said. So I kind of feel it used to work out that that it was always like 50-50, Democrats, Republicans. I didn't really try. It just was what was, it just naturally worked because you had the Democrats running the White House, you had the Republicans running Congress. But now it's like Trump, 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 and Trump, and then Ryan, and Ryan, and McConnell, and maybe a Schumer or two. So, you know, that's my big challenge, because I can't just only fact-check Republicans.
Glenn's traveled the world with three secretaries of state, as I said before. Mrs. Clinton was a special example. You told some funny stories before we met here. Tell the audience some of those stories about traveling with Mrs. Clinton.
Yeah, those stories are not for publication.
Okay. Well, sorry about that.
But you did say that you felt it made her more like more of a real person, right?
Yes, I'll say that. Mm-hmm. What's the future of fact-checking? Do you see this becoming more and more important, bigger, wider?
I'm quite involved with this international fact-checking network. We're going to have this summer our fourth international meeting. Last year it was in Argentina, this coming year it's in Spain. And it's really gratifying to see how people around the world have grabbed onto the idea of political fact-checking and holding politicians accountable. It's much easier in the United States than in some of these places where you have authoritarian or semi-authoritarian governments or you don't have very good access to reliable statistics. But the energy and the enthusiasm is really something to see. And so I really think it's going to really change the way people, it's going to force politicians to be much more accountable for their statements. And the another thing we do is also we track promises that politicians make. We have a page where we track 60 of Trump's promises. And a lot of these fact checkers in foreign countries do these promises. And it has an impact. So it's very gratifying to see.
I know it does, but at the same time playing devil's advocate, checking your fact for a second, we've seen politicians, as we said before, repeatedly lie again. And why aren't they taking more attention to the fact checker and other fact checkers across the country and around the world?
Well, I would, with the exception of Donald Trump, I would dispute the fact that politicians don't pay attention. I've seen many politicians change or drop talking points in response to fact checks. I know that ad makers of political ads routinely spend a lot of time working out what they're going to say in case if they get an inquiry from a fact checker. Just this week, I decided to fact check a 30-second radio ad. It had to do with the Affordable Care Act. And when I asked for the backup material, I received 9 pages of material to try to back up the facts that were in the ad.
What's your day like, your average typical day?
Well, I roll into the office. No, the day is endless. In the morning, I get up and we have to tweet out or post on Facebook the latest column, which appeared that morning. And then you check the social media traffic to see if there's any random tweets by the President of the United States that you need to fact check.
What are the odds?
We're usually working on several fact checks at once. There are some days where the well runs dry and we walk into the office and we have nothing planned. And we're just looking through transcripts or looking through, reader requests and things like that to see what can be checked. Somehow it always works out. and then the day ends, I leave the office usually around 7:30 or so. But then often I'm up late at night dealing with, people will be responding to fact checks up until midnight sometimes. So and the weekends are now shot because Trump keeps tweeting on Saturday mornings, so.
What's it like to have to follow his tweets all the time? He tweets erratically at all hours of day and night from all places in the world. What's it like for you and your colleagues to keep up with all these events?
It is what it is, That's the reality we live in.
Do you follow his social media besides the tweets? You follow his Facebook?
Yeah.
What's that like for you?
Well, let me put it this way. A good day is when I'm not fact-checking Trump.
Okay. I think it's time to have some questions from the audience. If people want to ask questions, please line up in the aisles. Microphone, please, and feel free to ask anything you want. Who has the first question for Glenn?
Yes?
Hi, my name is Rebecca. I'm a journalism student here. Well, thank you for coming to speak to us. But so I know you don't like this term, but fake news and hyper-partisan outlets like Breitbart and Think Progress have caused people's faith in the media to decline rapidly. So do you think in this day and age, journalists have an obligation to fact check not only politicians, but other news outlets just to preserve the sanctity of the Fourth Estate?
That's a very good question. Yeah, that's an excellent question. I sometimes will fact check those organizations in a derivative manner, in that if a politician will cite something they see in Breitbart, then I'll investigate whether or not the facts that were in that particular Breitbart article are correct. I've not found an instance when it was correct. At the moment, it's enough for me to keep track of politicians. If I'm also fact-checking other media organizations, it would be too much, and it would kind of take away from my mission. I could certainly see where you at some point someone creates a nonpartisan fact-checking website of media organizations. There is one of the fact-checking websites in England, it's one called Full Fact, is they will not only call out politicians, but they will also call out errors of fact that they find in the main newspapers in the UK. And there is this program that Facebook has started where they're asking some of the fact-checking organizations, members of the International Fact Checkers Network, to look at some of these fake news stories and debunk them. And then Facebook will flag them and remove them from people's social media feeds.
Hi, I'll take a specific example, okay? Okay. Does it work? Yeah, okay.
Mic drop.
All right, so everything that comes out of his mouth, Trump's, gets viral and it's all over the world. So I'll have a response from England 25 seconds after he said it. It's frightening. Mrs. Smith in Pennsylvania hears that all 100% of the iron that's going to go into this pipeline is from the United States. Isn't Mr. Trump wonderful? And then 20 minutes later, we find out that 40% of it is coming from Russia. But she's heard that fact. How do we dispel that in the public?
Well, I think people have to take some responsibility for the way they consume news. I mean, it's not on the media to, if Mrs. Smith in Pennsylvania only hears the one version of the story and then ignores the follow-up story, is that the media's fault or is that her fault?
Well, obviously it's her fault, but the fact is that it's true. These people that were duped were not listening to
right,
both
but
sides.
There's a lot of social science research that shows that people are more willing to absorb information that already fits their preconceived notions. So that's a big problem, and people have to be trained in order to fight against that tendency.
Thank you.
Sir?
You alluded to the evidence that Secretary Clinton was less dishonest during the campaign than the president, and yet she lost. So my question is there any correlation between candidates' honesty or dishonesty and their electoral success?
You want to hear the question?
Does lying help?
Yeah. Well, the question was, is there any connection between how often you make misstatements and what your electoral success is? I don't think there is. And I think it's a bit of a mistake to overanalyze the results of the last election. I mean, Hillary Clinton, lost the election for a variety of reasons. One of which, she lost Wisconsin. She didn't campaign in Wisconsin since April. There were tactical political mistakes she made. That if she got hit with this letter from the FBI director 10 days before the election. There were a variety of reasons why she lost, some of which were her own political mistakes. And face it, there was also a great deal of animus towards her as a person and the candidate, as there was against Donald Trump. So when people went into the voting booths and tried to decide, a lot of people were casting a negative ballot against her as opposed to a positive ballot again for him. And I happen to think that if Donald Trump had not made as many misstatements and had not been called out so many times for the way he is so cavalier with the facts, he probably would have done better. It hurt him a lot, particularly among college-educated voters. And ultimately, going forward, he is going to have trouble maintaining his credibility as long as he continues to act in this way, with this loose attitude about the facts. It's because now people are watching, people are counting on it. Members of Congress are not going to tolerate that if they feel he was not straight with them. Other foreign nations are not going to abide by that. So ultimately, it catches up with you.
Corinne?
Yeah. I realize you've probably been busy fact-checking politics for the last 50 days, but besides that, when you're not fact-checking politicians, what's some of your favorite things to fact-check?
Rather than politicians, what was I fact-checking?
I'm sorry, yeah. What else do you enjoy fact-checking?
Oh, well, the main thing is politicians. One series of articles I was particularly proud about was where I fact-checked statistics that were commonly cited in the media that turned out to be false. There were statistics about, for instance, alleged deaths by binge drinking by college students, which turned out to be based on very flawed methodology and then was mischaracterized in the media. I exposed a whole bunch of phony statistics having to do with sex trafficking. Sex trafficking is a horrific crime, but there's very little data. And what I've found is people will be more cavalier with the facts when it's an issue that such as sex trafficking, which is horrible, and so they're more willing to exaggerate the statistics in order to make a point. And it's important to be very statistically rigorous. I mean, there's an old, oftentimes prosecutors try to push through advances push the limits of prosecutorial discretion in mob cases, because who's going to be worried about the mob? But actually, those then set precedents that later might hurt ordinary people. So it's the same thing with statistics and bad situations like sex trafficking.
How do you avoid getting cynical about life in general, people lying all the time in your prisons?
I'm just not a cynical person.
But doesn't it make you hardened and more jaded in your day-to-day life?
I don't know. I ask my family.
All right. Next question, please.
Okay, well, thank you for helping make our world a little more honest place. I have two questions. With the proliferation of fact-checking organizations all over the world, how are they funded? How do they make money? And secondly, after you give, let's say, President Trump a 5 or 6 Pinocchio rating, and his followers just ignore it and say, we don't take him literally, we don't believe in facts. How do you respond to that?
Okay, well, in terms of the foreign news organizations, it's a mix. Some are attached to journalistic organizations like newspapers or television stations. Other cases, it's non-governmental organizations. They get funded through grants, fundraising. Funding is certainly an issue, and we're trying to address that. I'm attached to the Washington Post. That's not a problem. But for some of these nation organizations, it's certainly an issue. But there is also, they do a lot of crowdsourcing, crowdfunding. I know that my colleagues at PolitiFact, which is one of the U.S. ones, they recently did a crowdsourcing fundraising operation, and they hit their target within a few days. You know, it was, thank you, Donald Trump. As for Trump, you know, a lot of the false claims that Trump makes are things that his supporters already believe. And that's that why it resonates with them. So he might say, we're being flooded with illegal immigrants. So you can tell the people till they're blue in the face, till you're blue in the face, that no, actually, illegal immigration has gone way down in general, particularly from Mexico. But that's not going to matter to people that believe already what Donald Trump is telling them.
Thank you.
Hi. How are you? You worked the State Department beat for 10 years, correct?
Mm-hmm.
All right, I want to get my facts right.
please do.
Sorry. So today, Rex Tillerson, the Secretary of State, he left the country for his first Asia trip at a time when tensions with North Korea are pretty high due to the incident in Malaysia and recent bombs they've lobbed into the, or missiles they've lobbed into the sea. Did anything like that ever happen to you while you were on that beat? And if you were still on that beat today, what would your reaction be?
You're talking about the fact he went with no reporters?
He left with no no reporters on his plane.
Yeah, I'm appalled by the fact he did that. It makes absolutely no sense. Just to tell you how it worked with the secretaries I covered, not only did they always travel with a group of about 10 to 15 reporters, but they would brief on the record on just about every leg of the trip. So, and it was important. Not only is the private communication with the government important in terms of diplomacy, but also the public communication. So Condé Rice or Hillary Clinton, as they're landing in Beijing, know they're going to send certain messages, respond to questions from the reporters, and here's what she's trying to accomplish in Beijing. And then as soon as we land, we file the stories, and then the Chinese foreign minister and the foreign policy establishment of China sees what they want, the message they're bringing and what they want to talk about, and it has an impact. It actually helps the secretary advance their cause. And the idea that the Secretary of State would go without reporters is just unbelievable. And I don't quite know what he thinks he's going to accomplish.
Do you think it's intentional, or do you think it's just incompetence on part of people who haven't really worked in the government before, which is a lot of the Trump administration?
Well, I know, speaking to people that cover the State Department now, they have made it very clear what the standards were and how things have operated before. And if Rex Tillerson is perfectly able to pick up the phone and call his friend Condé Rice to find out how she did it.
Thank you.
Yeah. Hi, this is a little bit more of a methodology question. If you're trying to give someone Pinocchio's for a statement, are you just doing that based on a statement that cannot be validated to be true, or a statement that must have counter evidence to be proven false? Because there could be many statements which have no supporting evidence, or maybe more in a hypothetical nature, which are not true, but also may not be false. So how would you treat something like that?
Well, the standard is the burden of proof rests with the speaker. So if you go out and say, Barack Obama wiretapped my phones, it's not incumbent upon me to prove that Barack Obama wiretapped your phone. It's incumbent upon you to prove that Barack Obama wiretapped your phone. And if you can't provide me with evidence, then tough luck. The problem is yours. You shouldn't have said it in the first place.
Hi, so you had said that a day that you don't have to fact check Donald Trump is a good day. How many of those good days have you had?
Oh, boy.
Very good.
It's, you know, the night of the election when, you know, suddenly he won, the first thing I did was email my colleague and said, I can't believe we now have to fact check him for 4 years. Because we were like, you know, most people, we thought the election was going to go a particular way, so we assumed we were done fact-checking him. And it was quite a lot to fact-check him during the campaign. One of the reasons why we decided to start this 100 Days project to catalog every misstatement he makes was in part not to feel burdened with the idea of constantly fact-checking everything he said. You know, it's just there, so people see it. You know, if you want, there's the 220 in the first 50 days. Of those, we may have fact-checked 20 or 25. So we didn't have to do all of them.
Thank you. Alongside the fact-checking, the media got a pretty bad rap during the campaign for not going hard enough on President Trump or Hillary Clinton or other candidates. Do you think it was fair criticism?
What do you mean not going hard enough?
Well, people said the media were behind the curve. They weren't on top of things. They let President Trump say things and get away with things, and Hillary Clinton the same thing. You think the media were given a bad rap during the campaign, or did we really make mistakes?
Well, you know, no, of course, the media always makes mistakes. I kind of feel like, at least speaking for the Washington Post, we covered both candidates very aggressively. And we had the fact checker, which, you know, every statement, you know, we gave tons of Pinocchios to Hillary Clinton for many of her email statements, which were legalistic, misleading, and false. That's where she earned most of her Pinocchios. Mm-hmm. She was much better on policy, but when she had to talk about herself, she veered off course. And we didn't give Donald Trump a rest. And we did deep investigations into the Clinton Foundation and the Clinton funding, as well as a myriad of things that Donald Trump was involved. We even published a book, which is a really excellent book. I could say, I had nothing to do with it, but
what's it called?
It's called God. The senility is setting in here. Raising Trump, Trump rising. Anyway, if you Google Washington Post Trump book, you'll see it, and it's basically his life up until the point where he decided to run for president. It includes lots of interviews with Trump, and lots of revelations. I learned quite a bit, and I was covering Donald Trump when I was a business reporter at Newsday. In fact, we wrote one of the first stories saying Donald Trump was going around saying he was the king of cash and he was ready to go bankrupt. It was funny leading that story, and in fact, the speaker coming in a few weeks, Alan Sloan, he was my co-writer on that story. And reading that story 20 years later, it was amazing. It was the same Donald Trump saying all these things, and we methodically went through and said, no, that's false, that's false, that's false.
So he was the same person back then as a real estate magnate that he is now as the president, basically. Same kind of approach to the world?
Yeah, most people don't change as they grow older.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
What is your prediction for the influence of Trump and his team's misstatements on political culture in Washington as well as in the whole nation, meaning that, for example, so far, Republican politicians have not really opposed any of the even tremendous lies of Mr. Trump, but that might be partisanship. But besides journalists, there is like another institution which is based on neutrality and facts, which is like the bureaucracy. So, but he's the boss of the bureaucracy. So what are your predictions?
He's the boss of what, I'm sorry?
Like of the government administration.
Right, so you're asking whether or not he's changing the political culture of Washington?
For example, I think just recently there have been reports that the director of the FBI has said, was reported to have contacted Justice Department to make Trump take back these allegations of Obama spying on him. Do you think this will continue, or will they just back up and follow him, and what will happen with Republicans? Will they start to oppose him with time going on, or will they just follow him?
Well, I don't know. I'm
just repeat the question.
Yeah, it's essentially about whether or not, you know, is there any point, if I got it right, that is there any point where Republicans are going to push back against the way Trump is managing things? And he mentioned the example of the fact that FBI Director Comey requested the Justice Department to put out a statement saying that there was no spying of Obama, and the Justice Department has not done that. We don't know exactly what happened with his request, but clearly nothing has happened. You know, I'm not a political pundit. I'm just a reporter. I think you can't underestimate how. I think I'll put it this way: our political institutions are very resilient, and Trump is pushing the boundaries of those institutions. But there's a natural snapback, and you see some of that with the. Clearly, government officials are leaking the transcripts of his conversations, or they're providing information about the investigations. That's part of the pushback from the institutions in Washington. And ultimately, you know, in terms of the Republican leadership, they finally have a Republican president. They have lots of policies they want to have passed, tax bill, some replacement for Obamacare, that sort of thing. They are, at this point, reluctant to undercut a president of their own party. But if you're not successful, if you are unable to make a coherent case for your policies and you are not able to get your policies through, then politicians, they run in crowds. And so, and I think Trump recognizes this. You can see how he's diving into working to try to pass a replacement for the Affordable Care Act, because if he fails at this, that's a huge black eye. And it then undercuts whatever authority he has in Washington, and people are less scared of him. He came in, people were scared of his tweets. So it's important for him to be successful on this. And if he's not, and he splinters the party, and they're unable to go through, then it undercuts the whole image of a deal maker who's going to change Washington. So stay tuned. It's only been 50 days. We still have 1,500 or so to go.
Okay. So there's an idea online by personalities like Sam Hyde and Milo Yiannopoulos that Trump is playing what is fourth-dimensional chess, which is like he knows what he's saying is wrong. But by saying something incorrect, he'll bring attention to it. For example, by saying like, oh, the press didn't cover certain terrorist attacks. So then organizations like CNN will play clips of attacks that may have happened before just to bring publicity to his own agenda. Do you think that with so many incorrect statements that he's said so far, he truly believes the statements are wrong, or he's using the fact that he's saying incorrect statements to further his own agenda?
You know, my experience is that politicians are usually not as smart as they seem.
Is that a fact?
So, fourth dimensional chess seems a bit much to me.
Trump revealed,
yes, thank you. Yes, the Washington Post book is called Trump Revealed.
Okay.
And it's a really easy read, and you'll learn a lot. So, and it's in paperback now, too.
Donovan Alexis, a student journalist. In a satirical interview with The Daily Show correspondent Jordan Klepper, you said that there is no liberal reality or conservative reality, just only reality. You had also said that it was up to voters to decide what to do once they hear the facts. However, looking in hindsight, do you think that the country cared enough about the facts to make their decision, or did they completely buy into Trump's reality? And I'm pointing particularly to those who went from Democrat to Trump's corner.
Yeah, you know, the question was, he was quoting from some things that I had said when I was interviewed on The Daily Show. And you know, essentially the question was I was saying there was no liberal or conservative reality, there's just reality, and he was saying, and I made that interview before the election, he was saying, in hindsight, is that really the case? You know, particularly Democrats, people that voted for Obama and then voted for Trump, what happened there? They just ignored, you know, his falsehoods. Did I get that right?
Right. Yeah.
So the interesting thing is about American politics is for some strange reason, Americans make the choice of a president very personal. In a lot of other countries, people don't vote for the politician. They vote for the policy of the party. You know, it's like this is the slate of candidates for the Labor Party. And it's, you know, there is someone who might become the prime minister, but it's not really about the person, it's about the policies. And in fact, in a parliamentary system, if you can't get your policies through, the government falls. And in the United States, and I don't know, I've not studied enough to understand why this is the case, but for some reason, Americans, they want to have a connection with their candidate. And they feel like the candidate is working for them. And I think one thing that Trump was very effective at was when he was campaigning in these some of these places, and he was saying, I'm going to bring back the jobs that have been lost. I'm going to bring back all the coal jobs. Now, I could write fact checks till the cows come home and say, well, actually, those coal jobs aren't coming back. And in fact, they all went away because natural gas got cheaper. And, you know, and a lot of those trade jobs, jobs you claim were lost to trade, was actually lost to automation. But instead, Trump was appealing to that personal connection people feel when they vote for a president, because he was saying, I'm going to bring back your job. And I think that was effective. Now, again, in 4 years, those people in those towns might find out that he wasn't telling the truth.
We have a lot of students in the audience, student journalists. What's your advice for them when they enter the business?
Don't despair. There's a good future in it. In fact, in some ways, there's a better future than when I was going into it, because back then there were certain defined news organizations. There were newspapers, small newspapers, major newspapers. There were TV stations. There was the business press, maybe, and that was about it. But now you can become a journalist with just a computer keyboard and some good smarts, and you can write your articles and post it on the web and get yourself noticed. And there are all sorts of different platforms you can work for that didn't exist 5 years ago. So there's a lot more opportunity to possibly make your mark. Now, I don't know if you'll make any money in it. That's another matter. But I do think that the future is bright.
I remember 30 years ago, we were competing for a very small Wall Street newsletter industry, and now look where he is, and, well, I'm here, but look where he is. Question.
Hi, thank you very much. Thanks very much for tonight. I have two quick questions. The first one is, are there any fact checkers from Russia that attend your international conferences?
Any fact checkers on what?
From Russia.
Russia. Yes, I'm pretty sure, I don't have I know there are a couple in Ukraine which spend a lot of their time debunking fake news generated by Russia into Ukraine. There may also be the beginnings of a fact-checking organization in Russia. I'm not sure if they're based in Russia. There is a good fact-checking organization of Iran, and statements made by the Iranian parliamentarians, but they're based in Toronto, for obvious reasons.
My other question is, yesterday my accountant told me that even if Donald Trump were to release his tax returns, we would still not know if he had any investments in Russia or income from Russia. Do you have any insight into that?
You said even if the tax returns are released?
Even if his tax returns were released, we wouldn't be any more knowledgeable about what his investments were in Russia or what income he derived from Russia.
Well, I don't know. I think the tax returns would reveal a lot. It wouldn't necessarily, may not tell us about Russia, but it would tell us, give us lots of answers to many things. Ultimately, the truth comes out. That's what I feel.
So I was just wondering, in fact-checking, is there a threat of, say, government officials and an administration hedging information from, say, like Bureau of Labor, like the Department of Labor, maybe making certain numbers look better than they might actually be?
Well, that's a concern, definitely a concern. Don't forget those numbers are produced by career government officials who have done it for many, many years. So I guarantee you that if there is such pressure put on, we'll find out about it at the Washington Post.
Hi, thank you again for coming. Kind of as a follow-up, when you were talking about the future of journalism and kind of what you were saying about switching facts, What about blocking facts? As a seeker of truth and someone who believes in free speech, are you afraid of this administration's firewall of media they don't like, literally blocking news organizations from attending White House press conferences, et cetera? And what happens when there is a governmental attempt at censorship?
Government attempt at censorship, you said?
Yeah.
I'm not concerned about, I just don't think it'll happen in a sustained way. Like I said, the government institutions, I believe, are resilient. And maybe I'm just too much of an optimist. But having covered the White House, if you're missing the White House briefing, you're not missing much. Okay.
Last question?
Just a quick question. Thank you for your time. I just wanted to know a little bit insight of, on your daily average day, what databases or what type of places do you go to get to verify these facts? And on average, how long does it take for, you know, one of the statements?
Well, it just depends on what I'm checking. The internet has made it much easier because there are vast databases, government databases, with lots of statistics. But it also involves, you know, I've covered Washington now for 3 decades, so I have lots of sources and resources that I have trust and can rely on. And and sometimes it takes a while. I had to fact check some claim that Sean Hannity had made and involved like tracking down a retired general and going through his diary notes from the Persian Gulf War. But ultimately, I got the information I needed.
Thank you.
Yeah. Glenn, let me ask you one question, just prerogative. You brought up Asia before, so I don't want you to leave here without talking about the situation in North Korea. How dangerous? What's the likelihood that this will result in some kind of, you know, battle, war, missile attack? Where is this going? And this is obviously the most difficult problem facing the new administration. It's been around. You've covered it for 10 years. What's your thoughts about it?
Right. Well, I think of the world trouble spots, certainly North Korea is high on the list. You have a young ruler who seems to be rather impetuous, and you have years of American policy mistakes that have led us to this point. I mean, I covered very closely the North Korean issue when I was the diplomatic correspondent for the Washington Post. And, you know, at one point, all of North Korea's plutonium was under lock and key and kept in cooling ponds and 24/7 watched by the international inspectors. And during the run-up to the Iraq War, the Bush administration got distracted, got annoyed at something North Korea did, and basically nullified the agreement that allowed that plutonium to stay under lock and key. And he did it because of some elemental mistakes, because they weren't paying attention, because they were about to invade Iraq. And once that plutonium was removed, North Korea has been on a path that no one has been able to stop. I mean, in the second term, Bush realized he'd made a mistake and tried to get back that plutonium, and made concessions that Bush in the first term would have thought were ridiculous and horrible. But he was so desperate to solve the problem that he had created, he bent over backwards to try to fix it, and he couldn't. And Barack Obama, when he inherited the problem, he basically said, God, this is a mess, and he did nothing for 8 years. There was really no imperative to try to deal with it, because I'm sure every time the policymakers came to him with the options, he said, I have no options. And then you ended up with the fact that now, you know, no one quite expected we'd end up with this leader of North Korea, who has now decided to take that leash that, you know, various American administrations have provided and really run with it. And so they're getting close to miniaturizing nuclear weapons, their rockets are improving, and I don't know what the options are if I were advising the president. And it will require very delicate diplomacy. You cannot rely on the Chinese. The Chinese have always been a disappointment on this, because they will always feel that North Korea should be propped up. because they want a buffer zone between South Korea and the border with China. And it will require delicate diplomacy, and at the moment, I don't even know if they've even appointed any assistant secretary of state that could advise the president or the secretary of state on this. That's not an answer, but it is.
So on that cheery note, we're going to end a plug here. Glenn mentioned that our next speaker is Alan Sloan. You may know Alan Sloan. He's a very well-known business writer and reporter, economics. He's probably the most recognized and acclaimed business writer in the United States. He will be here April 24th, and we'll send out information. A plug.
If I could just add one thing.
Sure.
Alan Sloan is one of the funniest, most interesting people you'll ever meet.
That's true.
It'll be a delight, I guarantee you.
You may hear him on public radio, but he is really a remarkable guy, and I think you'll enjoy it. A little plug, when Glenn talked about the problem of confirmation bias and people looking at facts and not believing them, in fact, there are studies that say that the facts after, if you believe something strongly and you get a fact check, you believe it even more strongly after the fact check, although there's a new study that gives us hope that it's called the rebound effect, by the way. There's a new study that says that may not be true. And in fact, it may say that when you get accurate information, you may even think about your belief system and begin to change it. But one of the things we do in news literacy at Stony Brook, this course we have, is we work at this idea, how do you overcome your confirmation bias? How can students recognize their own bias, and then we give them exercises, and there is a site, I may have mentioned this to you before, there's a website called implicitbias.com. Take this down. If you want to test your own biases, if you want to see how good you are at overcoming biases, this is run by Harvard University and I think University of Washington, you can go on and take a test. This is a test that looks at your biases in terms of race, religion, weight, age, and 5 or 10 minutes, and it will report back to you whether you harbor biases or not. By the way, the students in our news literacy program hate this test. They despise this test. They all say, how could this be possible? How could I have a bias about anything? So implicitbias.com is something I would suggest everybody go to because it's interesting. And on that note, please join me in thanking John and wishing Glenn great success ahead.
Okay, all right.